And here is Johnny on the spot.
Meet the doyen of clever songwriting and popular music historian. Enlightening stories, terrific tips, and even a few laughs along the way. A veritable potpourri of fun. Robin Frederick. Well, here we are, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Johnny on the Spot. I'm Johnny, brought to you by Turtleneck Productions, because as we all know, I have a turtleneck. You know, Robin, somewhere in the world is a little turtle with my neck, and I want it back, for gosh sake.
Okay, is that where it went?
That's right. It's a walk. It's running. It's meandering about the world. My guest today is the wonderful Robin Frederick. You can read all about her in my the opening notes on the video cast. See what I learned today? Robin said, well, is it a podcast or a video cast? And I said, no, it's a podcast. And she goes, oh, so it's audio only. And I said, no, it's audio and video. And then she said, well, it's a video cast. So it's a video cast.
It's good for people to know, your guests to know, because they won't show up in their pajamas, or maybe they will. When it's a video cast. So you should want to let them know.
Pajama cast. I think you've just
pajama
hit
pajama cast.
Now,
I like that even better. Yeah. That would be a nice, that would be a good hook for a video cast.
Pajama cast.
And everybody shows up in their pajamas and gets interviewed in their pajamas. I think it's a great idea.
You
could interview
PC,
celebrities in their pajamas.
PC pajama cast.
Yeah.
So that'd be great. I think we're going to do that. Let's start that. Well, maybe people would not want to see me in my tiger pajamas. I don't know.
Ooh, in your tiger pajamas. Yeah.
Bengal, don't you know?
Yeah. Yeah, you'd like to see me in my unicorn pajamas. I have them.
Do you really?
I do, yeah.
Okay, good. Little known fact. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about songwriting.
Mm-hmm, good.
You are an expert. You're a teacher. You can see in the background of Robin there, just a couple of her books, all available on Amazon. There'll be connections at the end that you can check out. But more importantly, I've got to say, I took a deep dive on some of your writing last night, and I literally went down a rabbit hole in a good way. I think going down a rabbit hole is basically good, anyways. But I love to do that. When I hear something or I see something, I like to learn what I can about it. And it usually sends me off in different trajectories. But your writing just in and of itself is really, really good. And I'm not even talking about your songwriting. I'm just talking about your writing ability and being as I have for many years, a children's music reviewer. I'm always looking for that opening line or that hook to get you into the piece. But what I found with your writing is extremely conversational. It's funny, it's insightful, and so on and so forth. So jumping off from that, I went, you know, I haven't heard, this may be the longest question you've ever had. I haven't heard, just go get a sandwich. I'll be done in a few minutes. You know, I haven't heard your music in so long. So, and it reminds me of another story, and I listened to your albums. Your album covers, by the way, are beautiful.
Thank you.
But your song, your voice is so lovely. And I fell in love with your music all over again. It was really wonderful. And then taking the side paths, I remember, this is the story, you had me play guitar on something, and I was like totally freaked out because it was a little bit out of my comfort zone. You know, four chords is out of my comfort zone. And you might remember, but it was an octave lead, and I don't remember what it was. I think it was a couple of songs, and I didn't sleep the night before. Oh. And it was a victorious situation, because whatever it was, whether you used it or not is not the point. Thinking Steely Dan. I did it. It worked for that moment. It was a victory on my part. And your part as well for trusting me in doing that. But I thought about that last night. Couldn't go to sleep again. So that brings me up to date right now to re-meet you, one of my heroes in my adventure called life.
We were talking about how long it's been. I don't even want to say how long it's been. It's been decades since we had a talk. And So, you know, your memories of that time, mine are more vague than yours are. So we don't have to go back there. But you brought up a lot of things that are fun and interesting to talk about. I'm a songwriting geek. I love songwriting. I can bore people to death talking about, oh, look how that song did that repetition of rhythmical riffs right through that. I love that way that did that. And I'm mostly talking to other songwriters. And so I get my fill of, you know, songwriting geeking out a lot, and I really enjoy it. And that's what my books are. I'm geeking out. And a lot of my news, every month I do a hit song guide in my newsletter every month. And I get to do it then. And writing for me, growing up, I knew I was going to be a writer. That was my decision very early on, probably about 12, 13 years old, I'd already written a musical. I mean, I was already going to be a writer, but I just couldn't decide which kind of writer. I knew I wanted to write songs, but I also like to write plays and I like to write prose. And finally, I just ended up writing all kinds of stuff. With the internet, you do that because if you want to reach out to people and communicate with people, you can do it this way by, you know, talking together, which is really nice, doing something that's audio, video. But you can also write a lot and you know, send that out to people or post it on your website. There's lots of opportunities for people who, you know, 20 years ago or 30 years ago would not have had any of these outlets. You wrote for magazines and you had to get accepted by a magazine to get your song, your writing into magazines. And there just wasn't that much work available. Now you can, you know, reach people with your writing. And I think the idea for me, writing is a combination of talking to people, like you said, being conversational and being interesting, which takes some, you know, imagery and some vivid language, some words maybe you don't expect. And that's the fun of writing a lot of times is saying things that people may not expect in a way they don't expect. But that's the same is true of songwriting. It's writing a line that's both conversational and honest and authentic, and at the same time being entertaining and giving people a vivid experience that they can share with you. I mean, why else would you listen to some stranger's song if you couldn't get engaged in it, you know?
It's how a song like Strawberry Fields, for instance, right? Which is quite boom, right? It bounces. And it's like, let me take you down Strawberry Fields. It's like a song can touch so many different people in so many different ways, perhaps totally unbeknownst to what the songwriter's original intent was, if there was an intent.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Very different.
That's what's so great about it. That's what's so magical.
Yeah, so you've never been to Strawberry Fields, and I've never been to Strawberry Fields, but because of the name, which suggests what Strawberry Fields might feel like or look like, we can all get engaged in, let me take you to this beautiful, lovely place, you know, filled with fruits and vines, and join me there, and we'll have this wonderful experience. That song, I'm glad you mentioned that song, because it's a great example of using imagery, even though John Lennon may know, and I think there is a real place called Strawberry Fields, but it's not nearly as cool as what the listener imagines it to be. Right. Yeah. So what we do when we write from our own lives, which we do and we should do, we have to make it, it's not just for us, it's for strangers, people that John Lennon never met. And yet we can all be transported to Strawberry Fields, or we can see Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, or we can imagine what it's like, you know, here comes
Penny
the
Lane.
Sun King.
Penny Lane, huh? Right? There's a... Yeah. A village that it's a very British village, but yet we can relate to it, you know, in a small town, big town, whatever. I want to talk about a song of yours that I ran across last night. Is it, correct me if I'm wrong, is it Sandy Gray?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful, because it really follows through with what you were just saying. And I saw why you initially wrote the song, to fill in some gaps of trying to fill in some emotion with a friend who was going through a very, very dark time and was absent a lot in a lot of different ways. And yet that song, and obviously the testimony is it's been recorded many times by many different people. Your version of it, I happen to like the best.
Oh, thank you.
Because I'm kissing your ass. That's what I'm doing.
People may want to know who it was written for. A lot of people do know who Nick Drake is. Yeah. And he was a friend of mine in an early time when he was actually in pretty happy. In fact, he was, I think, more comfortable during that year that he spent living in the south of France than at any other time in his life. And I was there and we met and we played songs for each other. And I, one night he stood me up. He was supposed to meet me at a cafe and he didn't show and I was angry. And I went home and I wrote Sandy Gray about a character. I just called him Sandy Gray because that's what he was. You really couldn't get a hold on him. He was like holding sand, you know?
Oh, Sandy Gray, are you going away? Leave me a message before parting. Time has changed you. And the things that pained you are the things you think of as you're starting.
And he was a very
gray being in between.
You couldn't really hold him in any way. Because he would just slip away. There just wasn't a kind of transparent person. And what's interesting, so I called him Sandy Gray. He most likely wrote Thoughts of Mary Jane about me because he was calling me Mary Jane because I wrote a song called Been Smoking Too Long, which he covered on his album. And so it was
beautiful. Who can know the thoughts of Mary Jane? Why she flies or goes out in the rain? Where she's been?
Well, I wake up in the morning, look at my clock. It's way past noontime, know I'm late for work. Tell me, what have I done wrong? And nothing go right with me, must be I've been smoking too long.
And so it was, we were talking to each other with songs, and I was using an image, Sandy Gray, two words that evoke that sense of transparency and loss, and you can't hold on to it. That's why I called him that. It's the same reason that Strawberry Fields works, to evoke a thought, an image in the listener, a response, an emotional response in the listener. So if I call him Sandy Gray, if I call him Nick Drake, nobody knew who Nick Drake was until just a few years ago. Nobody knew, and we never thought that would happen. Whoever guessed that. But by calling him Sandy Gray, the listener could imagine who that person might be. So when I went to England shortly after being in France, I went to London and I met another British folk singer named John Martin. And John was making his first album and he liked that song a lot. And he recorded it on his first album called London Conversation. And that was sort of the beginning of that song getting out there to people. And then,
oh, Sandy Gray, it's only this I pray, that you might stay here one more day in laughter. Won't you hang around and hold me, repeat all the lines you told me to your rambling after.
Oh, Sandy. And that was sort of the beginning of that song getting out there to people. And then later, Nick had put it a different song of mine on a demo, but he never recorded Sandy Gray. I don't know if he ever heard it, but John Martin did. And later, John and Nick became best friends. It was really odd.
Wow.
And It's just this odd little combination of things. But the point is, when you write about personal experience, and I'm glad you brought this up because I was just dealing with this with a songwriter who's a client, a coaching client of mine, who wrote about his own life as an incident in his life. And he kept wanting to finish the song with a twist. He wanted to change the emotion to what actually happened in life. And I said, no, that's a different song. You don't want to change the emotion for the listener because they're already in the emotion that you want them to be in. Leave it there, finish the song and leave them there. Then write a new song about this other emotion that you want to talk about. And he said, but that's the way it happened. And I said, but strangers don't care about how it happened. They don't care about you. They want to feel it themselves and say, oh, I've felt that way. I have. And maybe it didn't end that way for them. It ended, you know, or maybe it did. Who knows? But by telling them what they should feel, they generally won't go there. They want to take in what you're singing. And if they can relate to it, they will.
That's really interesting because that has many components of a song doctor. You know,
yes.
You come in, doctor, I've got a pain. Oh, it hurts when I do this. Well, don't do that. Continue.
That's what I am. I am a song doctor. That is what I am.
You are a song doctor.
I coach people that way.
You know, I'm not a prolific songwriter by any means. I remember the old Lerner and Lowe. I might be quoting this wrong. Lerner, it was a songwriting team. They said, how do you get your inspiration? And he goes, well, the phone rings and they usually offer a lot of money. Well, that's not always the way it works.
What starts a song? The phone call.
Whatever
it's an old quote. Yeah.
Right. An old quote.
Yes.
And so, I usually have to be inspired by something, whether it's a person, a muse, or muse doesn't have to necessarily always be a person. But in your case, what I get the Sandy Gray. That's right at home for you. Where do your inspirations come from? Or is that one of those things?
No, it's not. Inspiration is necessary for every song. I fully believe in that. But you can't wait around for inspiration. So if you're going to make a career out of songwriting, you have to be able to write on demand. So for example, after I wrote a lot of songs, you know, from pure inspiration, just this is what's happening to me in my life and I feel like singing about it. When I moved to Los Angeles and I began working which is when I first met you, and I began working as a songwriter for a living, then I was writing for the Disney Channel. I was writing 3 to 4 songs a week.
Yeah.
And my inspiration was the script. They'd send me the script
deadline
for the show on Wednesday, and I had to start writing songs on Thursday morning, and then I had to be in the studio on Monday with the band to record them so that the stage would have something to shoot on Tuesday. And if they didn't have anything to shoot, it was $20,000 and the stage was dark for the day. That was my fault. So you learn that creativity, which is different from inspiration, creativity is not a fragile little bird that comes and sits on your shoulder. And if you look at it, it flies away. Creativity is a muscle. And the more you
work it. I get that a lot, by the way, the little bird on the shoulder. There we go again. See ya.
Yeah, but it's not. I mean, creativity is really a muscle. And the more you work it, the stronger it gets. Just like anything else. Anything else that you do, you know, if you're a baseball player, and the more you hit the ball, the more accurate you are, and the more muscle strength and accuracy you have. It's the same. And so when I was working on the Disney stuff, I would be given the script, I would spot the script where the songs went, and I would sit down and I would let the characters inspire me. What do they want to say? What would they say in this situation? What would they sing about? And it was Winnie the Pooh was the first show I worked on, Welcome to Pooh Corner. But mainly it was Phil Barron and me. And Phil and I wrote, we weren't writing together. He had a writing partner. And they would give us, each of us, a script for the week, and we would both go to work on them. And so I wrote 205 songs in 3 years, wrote and produced them with a band. I wasn't there at that time. We didn't have MIDI and, you know, we weren't able to home studios. We really didn't have them. So I would do a demo, give it to the arranger. The arranger would do an arrangement. The arranger would give it to the copyist. The copyist would write it all out on Sunday night, just like crazy, and then bring them in, put them on the music stands at 9 o'clock on Monday morning, and we would downbeat at nine. And I would take the band through my two songs plus reprises, and then Phil would come in and do it in the afternoon. And we did that week after week after week. And so I learned that if you have to write a song, you find inspiration somewhere to write it. So you know that. You've done plays, you've done musicals, and you knew when your opening night was going to be with your music, school or whatever was doing it. You knew what your deadline was, and you got your songs done.
I have this vision of you having a Winnie the Pooh stuffed little bear and you just go over and punch it occasionally.
I probably wanted
like a bataka, you know, get your aggressions out of it. But what great training, really.
Exactly. It was incredible training and I got paid for it. Thank you very much, being a working songwriter, finally. It's a hard thing to be, but it's also the best training you could possibly have to go on when you're going to be writing on spec for music briefs. So now what you get, you'll get a brief from a music supervisor, let's say, or from a music library. They'll give you a brief and say, we're looking for, a library might be looking to put together an album of Latin songs, upbeat Latin songs. Okay. And so you get the brief and you go, well, I can't really do that because I don't speak Spanish well. And so, and Latin grooves are not my thing. So you pass on that one because it doesn't take advantage of your strengths. But if you got a music brief that said, we're looking for upbeat children's songs with a contemporary flavor, you'd go, yeah, I'll take a shot at that one because that's my strength. I know how to do it. So any experience that you get along the way in, you know, going from A to B to C to D all the way through your career, all of that comes, you use all of it, depending on where you have experience and what you like doing. Never write a song you don't like because you'll never know when that song is done. Jeff Berry said that to me one time. You can't write a song you hate, you don't like, because how will you know when it's done? I thought about that for the longest time. What does that mean? And then finally I said, oh, it's because every choice you make as you write a song is a choice that feels good to you. Oh, that feels right. That feels good. I'll do that. You can't say, oh, I hate that. I'll keep that because I can't
stand it. What the analogy is on that is in with acting, of playing reprehensible characters, you don't have to love them, but you've got to get inside to find out what motivates them.
Right, you do.
Right,
you
otherwise the performance is not gonna be true.
And that's the word, and it applies to songwriting also. Truth, authenticity, honesty, all of those that has to be there, or the listener knows, and they will tune right out. They won't believe you. They're not interested. They lose
interest. The big word these days is authentic, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Your
authentic self, or your, it's a buzzword, but it's also very, very true.
Every time I ask a music supervisor, when you hear a song that you know you'll use at some point, but you maybe not right now, but you know it's a song you could use, what is it about that song that makes you know that? And they all say the same thing, authenticity.
Yeah.
But when I say, what is authenticity? They all go, I don't know, but I know it when I hear it. And so I've struggled with that. I've written about authenticity in songwriting because what is that? It's the willingness to express your emotions fully and honestly in whatever type of song you're writing about, and find ways to say that so that the listener will feel what you feel. And you, in order to do that, you have to go, even if it's an experience you haven't had, you still have to, like an actor playing somebody really evil, and watching Heath Ledger get into the Joker the way he did. I don't know that you have to go quite that far, but you do have to experience and inside and say, what would it feel like if I were that person doing what that person is doing? Why would I do that? And you have to feel it yourself. Then you can write about it. Then you can act it. Then you can express it.
Right. And that's a very, very, very good point. With the Heath Ledger of getting so deep within something, you're at peril of getting your way back out, of pulling yourself back out of that space that you've gone to. The difference with, acting from the outside and acting from the inside, you know, the old Laurence Olivier story in Dustin Hoffman. Remember that, where Marathon Man, and Dustin Hoffman's got to run around the block because we get sweating, and he comes back in so we can do the scene. And Olivier said, well, try acting, my boy.
Yes. You know, he really didn't agree with Stanislavski at all.
But whatever. And Dustin Hoffman's going, hey, this works for me, you know, whatever, Larry. Boy, that's really that brings up a variety of questions. So you at this point, we're talking about with Disney. What year would you think?
That was the 80s. I worked freelanced for Disney as a songwriter for the channel in the 80s, and then I produced albums for Walt Disney Records in
the
90s.
That's what I wanted to ask you about. Now that's a whole. That's a whole different set of tools.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Using everything you've learned from that part as your toolbox is getting heavier now, but mm-hmm. filled with these magical elements. How did you help the process with the artists at that point?
Well, the funny thing about the artist is the artist was Mickey Mouse. I mean, the artist wasn't an artist. The artist.
Oh, I know that with Disney, but after that, didn't you work with a variety of different albums?
After that, I went to work for Rhino Records.
I
executive produced 60 albums in just like 3 or 4 years. And those albums, many of them were with the Warner Brothers characters, the Looney Tunes, the Flintstones, Animaniacs, and I had already been working with the Little Mermaid and Winnie the Pooh. I had a lot of experience doing that, which is an odd thing to have experience at in the first place. And then to have it be at two different companies and using those sets, that skill set was very unusual. But I also, I did other styles of compilations, mostly at Rhino, but I was a signed artist with Higher Octave Music. I was signed as a New Age artist, and I was doing songs for, which you may have heard some of those that I did for Higher Octave. And then I was also a signed artist at Golden Books, and I did an album for Golden Books. So there was this kind of pull between these two the two sides of what I was able to do, but it's the same skill set.
Right.
And if you have strengths in both and you love both, then you don't want to not do one of them, you know, and sacrifice that for the other and say, well, I won't allow myself to do that. I went ahead and took those opportunities that I felt that I could do and wanted to do, because I would have felt terrible if I said no to one of them.
Because those Animaniacs, man, they're animals.
I know, aren't they? I love them.
Me too. You don't want to get a call from them. Hiya, how you doing? You
know? Yeah, yeah. I also work with Ronald McDonald and all of the McDonald's characters, and they were wonderful. That was some of the best albums I ever made, was with Ronald McDonald. I did 3 of them, and we sold 12 million of them. And I know.
That bought your house and your yacht.
That's right. That's right.
And the mansion on the hill. I remember you have an older sister, right?
Yeah.
Is it Carla?
No, Carla's my younger sister, and she passed away a few years ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
But she was a recording engineer.
That's right.
That's what you're remembering, yes. We worked together for many years. We were partners, and she recorded and mixed everything I did, and she was really good.
She was really good.
Yeah,
I think during that time when we first met, I think she was somehow involved with Fleetwood Mac or something.
Yes, she was there. She assisted, was assistant engineer on the album After Tusk.
Yeah.
And sometimes she was first engineer. Yeah, she worked with Fleetwood extensively. Yes.
Yeah. And now your older sister, is she still alive?
Oh, yeah. And she taught theater, speaking of acting. So the reason I know anything at all about acting and how much it affects how vocal singing is because of her. And she taught acting and theater arts and was a costumer for many, many years.
Oh, what's her name?
In the San Francisco Bay Area. Yeah.
What's her name?
Marcia Frederick.
Marcia. Okay, great. Mm-hmm. I only thought you had the one sister. That's correct. That's cool.
The other one's Carla.
About Carla. Yeah. But she was extreme. I had an opportunity to meet her a couple of times.
Yeah, it was unusual to be. It's difficult being a woman in the business. It still is, being a woman in the music business. And to be producing was really unusual when I was doing that in the early 80s. And Carla was an assistant engineer at a studio that had hired a few women as assistant engineers who were all very, very good, the Village Recorder. And they were all working with various very high level bands, Steely Dan and Fleetwood Mac and Supertramp and all the bands that were big at the time, because they came through that studio. It was a very high end, world-class studio. And so she was doing that. And then at night, I would, because I worked there also for a few years early on, and before I did the Disney things. And, you know, there's a saying in the music industry, every break you get, everything that happens to you happens because of someone you know. And I look back on my very strange career, and that's true. I went to work at the Village because I was the nighttime manager, and I thought, well, I'll meet some famous, some, you know, hot music people, and I'll co-write with them. Won't that be fun? And so my job kept me too busy to actually do a lot of that. But, and I also discovered that he didn't really want to write on spec for radio. I never did care a lot for that. I want to have a reason to write. I need an assignment to write. And it comes back to what you were saying earlier, that if you don't have a reason to write, it's very hard actually to get yourself in gear and do it. And I didn't like writing on spec for no money, meaning, you know, you write a song and then you hope you can get a music publisher to take it. I never liked that. And so I actually continued to write the children's family entertainment musicals for educational purposes while I was working at the Village Recorder. And that kept going. And one of the engineers there, she left and went to work for Mattel. And she said, Mattel needs somebody to write some songs. And I know you do that because I see you doing it sometimes. So would you be interested? And I said, sure. So I went to work then freelance for Mattel. Mm-hmm. And I wrote things like The Cow Says Moo. And I mean, literally, I wrote that for the Pull the Ring toys. Somebody had to. And I did that for a while, for a couple of years. And then one of the writers who was working under me for on a computer, a talking computer, she said, I just got a job with the Disney Channel and they're looking for somebody to write a few songs. Are you interested? And I said, sure, thinking I'll write five songs or something. And that's where I ended up writing 205 songs in 3 years, was that job.
But it's person to person, right?
Yeah. You look at, just whoever you're with, you know, make sure that you look around you all the time. I think people make a mistake when they don't look at who's next to them in their class. If you're taking a music class or a songwriting or a singing class or something, look around you and meet the people who are there, because those are the people you're going to grow up with in the business. One of them is going to get a gig and you're going to go along for the ride because somebody needs somebody else. And so as far as, you know, like, whenever anybody asks me, when they do ask me about advice on getting an entertainment career going, and it's the same for actors, absolutely. Yeah. When they say who you know, people make the mistake of thinking it's somebody higher up than you. And yeah, that can help, but it's actually your peers. It's the people around you that will take steps and you'll step along with them.
Kind of go up in a group, right? A
level. When you see actors, you see them in a group a lot of times, the Rat Pack and the Brat Pack, and you see actors doing the same thing. You see a group of them coming along and they're all friends. They all know each other.
You know, I interviewed, it was a friend of mine, Chris Lansdowne, funny you bring up Mattel. She was the voice of Barbie in those early toys and games. And so there's that crossover synergy of all those elements going together to create this. She was just recently up in Canada. I think they inducted Barbie into the Toy Hall of Fame or something.
Oh, that's so cute.
Participated at. And of course, timing with the movie. Yeah, that's an interesting point, and I've addressed it over the years, is you think of England being an island, a small country, and yet where do all these great white blues players come from?
A disproportionate number of our hit songs and hit artists come out of that small little island
Isn't that
over
interesting?
There.
Interesting. I mean, like,
I have asked myself the same question.
John Mayall's group, right? You go, oh, what are you going to do? You just lost Eric Clapton. He goes, I got a guy I think's better named Peter Green. You know, it's like you're going, where are these guys? And how do they know that the essence of they all studied, they locked themselves into the room.
Yeah, and we weren't doing that in America. We were taking our blues artists for granted, and for the most part, and Britain, the artists, the singer-songwriters and guitar players were studying them really hard. And that's why they were all touring over in Europe and England. Yeah. There's a wonderful book, by the way, if anybody's interested, called White Bicycles by Joe Boyd. And Joe Boyd was the producer for Fairport Convention and Nick Drake and Sandy Denny and the Incredible String Band. And he's an American, but he went over to London with a blues tour, and he ended up staying and working with a lot of the folk acts over there. But the blues tour that he did, he writes about it in White Bicycles. He writes about the Newport Folk Festival, where Dylan went electric because Joe was the stage manager. And he writes about all these wonderful things. Joe was the kind of guy, the Forrest Gump of music throughout all the 60s and into the 70s. Yeah. And that's a wonderful book, White Bicycles. You can't put it down once you start reading it. And these stories of how blues, the American blues artists, were revered in Europe and England, but not at home. And to pick up on your point there, where you started with, that's a great, you see that clearly in the tours that England was embracing, and England and the UK was, and Europe was bringing over. And they were not touring at home. They were still on the Chitlin circuit. They couldn't get out of the race problem.
Right. That's the essence of it. Europe, France in particular, they were very, very open.
Yes,
to,
they were.
To people of all ethnicities. But you know what? They don't write pieces like "What This Country Needs Is a Good 5-Cent Bubblegum Cigar" anymore. And you know what? It's appropriate today.
True. People won't know what that is. So we should tell them that when I was writing plays, as I said, I was doing when I was at the Village, I would write children's educational musicals at night. And even before I went to the Village, I would write those, and I had a theater that would put them on, and that one had been put on. And then I met John, and you were looking for some educational musicals to tour. Yeah. And that's how I met you, was you did that show and took it around. And you're right, these things keep coming back.
Now, going back to your point about people to people, did somebody introduce us?
Lee Kopp.
It was Lee.
Yes, you mentioned him earlier. Yeah, before we got on the air, he mentioned this guy that from years ago, and I immediately recognized him. Oh yeah, Lee was the one who introduced us, and that's exactly what I was talking about.
Yeah,
I met him through my sister, who was doing theater. Lee was doing theater, and that's how I met Lee. And when I moved to Los Angeles, Lee introduced me to you.
Great, and I've already talked to Lee about interviewing him down the road.
Good.
So that will bring. I also want to talk to Janet Roston, who was a choreographer.
You should
on that piece, and she was when we did Mr. Toad, Rides Again. I mean, I still wake up in cold sweats of learning her choreography.
She's a pro, and she expects her dancers to be pros. She's had a very interesting career, also educational, and then also working in television as a choreographer. And she was working with you. I remember that's how I met Janet, and we have been friends for years also. Yep. And so you never know. Again, as I was saying, if you look around you at the people who are your peers, instead of thinking, I'm going to go meet the head of a record company or a music publishing company, I've got to meet those gatekeepers, I got to get in there. And so many people I know are frustrated by that. Yes. Instead, look at your peers and watch what they're doing. Get together as a group and start, doing shows or doing songs or putting together open mic nights. Do whatever it takes as a group to get yourself out there. I think you were involved when I did a cassette of children's artists that I just called out of the blue. This was before I had worked anywhere like Rhino or Disney. Uh-huh. And I called children's artists and said, do you want to be on this cassette? Contribute $20 so I can get them made. And then I got a list of bookstores and I sent out the cassette to all these bookstores of children's artists they might not have heard of. And Dan Crow was on there, and I can't even remember, it was so long ago. I'm sure you were on there with one of the songs from 5 Cent Bubblegum Cigar. Yes. And just by doing that, I met a lot of people. And they looked up to me and said, wow, you're putting this together. And I'm going, yeah, but you could do this. And just find out what you can do, where you are at whatever stage of your career you're at, because you never know who you're going to meet.
Does this ring a bell? Going to the store, going to the store.
That's the one that keeps me up at night. Every once in a while, I'm going to the grocery store, that thing comes back to me, going to the store, going to the store.
That's specific. That's a specific.
Yes, well, specific.
You kind of get the meaning of it right from the get-go.
What's fun about this is that we can still sing those songs, and so can probably every kid you ever performed it for. Yeah. I have adults, and now I have grandparents who email me, who find me, and they email me and say, did you make that record for Golden Books with this song on it? And they can sing A Warm Woolly Hat right back to me. And kids who grew up listening to my Disney songs, they can all sing those songs back to me. When you write songs for family entertainment, which is children and adults. Yeah. And you have to, because the adults are in the room, you really do have to have really good quality for kids. When you do that, you're changing their lives. They will remember that song their whole lives. And mm-hmm. and maybe it's just a fun riff that they can't get out of their heads, but other times it's a song that had a message for them when they were little, or had an emotional it resonated for them emotionally. And when you're little, you have huge emotions and you don't really know what to do about them. Mm-hmm. And so one of these songs comes along and helps you understand that. And that stays with you your whole life. So when we write for children, we have an obligation to write songs that are authentic, that are honest, that say something that people of all ages will resonate with and say, that's true. Mm-hmm. I can feel that too. Even adults, I think adults should remember more of their childhood and not forget about what it felt like to be a kid.
You know, so it's that song or album that you go to sleep with, right?
The
children have, and it's their favorite. Well, they can't sleep without their favorite album, song, or whatever. And yet that is permeating into the sleeping psyche of peace and tranquility. You know,
it becomes also
like a warm blanket.
It's where I was going to say, it's comfort. It's comfort music. And even my album for Golden Books, which was called Rock and Road Game Songs, I mean, it's all like really up tempo, fun stuff. Yeah. I know kids, little kids, because my friends, their parents would tell me, she listens to that every night to go to sleep to. And I'm thinking, that's really odd, but it's not. It's what it is the song's familiar. The voice is familiar.
Right.
It's a voice familiar they really like. And that's, and a child, it becomes you become their friend. And you have a big influence on their life. As you say, they'll fall asleep to that and it gets really deeply embedded.
Now, you're obviously a very popular teacher of music. Was that something that was prompted by someone or just a decision that you made? Because, I mean, you get ideas and you run with it. Did you at some point just say, you know what, I'm going to teach people how to write songs, or how did that come about?
My sister Marcia was teaching theater. I thought maybe I'll do teaching, and I had a long talk or five with her, and she gave me the lowdown. I didn't want to be an academic teacher. I didn't want to go to an institution and have to do grades and stuff. That didn't appeal to me at all.
Yeah.
But I started teaching on the weekends for community outreach. Like, so Pasadena City College has a community. You can join, you know, community classes on the weekends. And so I started doing that, and I found that I was good at organizing information for people. And then I began writing materials for them to take home with them. And that became the basis of my book, that Shortcuts to Hit Songwriting, right there. That later on in 2007 became the basis of that book, which I then wrote over the following one or two years.
Yeah.
And I found that I really enjoyed it, not having the deadlines and the, you know, having to produce music, having to be in the studio with the clock running and the budget limitations and all those things that I had at Rhino and I had at Disney. Then I could really just share all those things I learned all those years with other people. And it was fun then to watch them have to do all that stuff.
Yeah.
So now I have clients now who are getting songs into film and television. I had a client who got a song into Station 19 recently, and another client who's been in films and also in New York East, I think it's called. All kinds of the kinds of things that I used to do. But when I took another look, I came back after working in film and television back in the 80s, I came back to look at it again in the 1990s and early 2000s, and everything had changed. Now you weren't writing songs to scripts, now you were writing songs for your own CD. And then music supervisors were coming to look for them and find a song that would fit the scene that they already had shot. So it was flipped. It was exactly the other way around.
Yeah.
And that meant that the songs themselves had to function differently than they did when I was writing on the assignment for a specific spot in a specific script. Now you have to write songs if you're going to do this, and you should write as your artistic self and be honest, because you have to be. Now, if you write a song that says, I love you, this is what love feels like, this is what my love for you feels like, that song could be used under any scene in which someone is falling in love with someone else. So now I teach songwriting, Shortcuts to Songwriting for Film and TV, the other book.
Yeah.
Now I spent a couple of years studying all of that to see what was different. And then I said, oh, this is quite different from writing songs for radio. Now this is about writing songs about common scenes and emotions that happen to all of us, because that's what film and television scenes are about.
That's
we can
right.
all identify with those. So now you need a song that says, this is what love feels like, this is what a broken heart feels like, this is what anger feels like. And you have to write it in a way that's honest and evocative for listeners. And that's what writing songs for you as an artist, and then those songs get used in film.
And by the way, that same philosophy works for children as well. Mr. Rogers was so adept at writing, getting in touch with anger or feelings of bereavement or so on and so forth. But
yes.
you answered a question that I was going to ask, and that is how songwriting has changed. You know what? I was thinking the other day of how many songs are in TV shows now at the end of the TV show. And I remember Miami. Do you remember Miami Vice?
Oh, yes. I love that show.
Remember Phil Collins' song, the Phil Collins? There's something in the air tonight.
It's something in the air tonight. Yeah. Yeah.
If it dovetailed so completely right with what was going on in the show, and I don't think you, I'm sure there are people that just look for songs that fit. You're not writing that particular song for that particular show.
No, and
finding a song of the worst, right?
Yeah, I urge people not to do that, to write about your real feelings in a real way. And then your feelings will be shared by others. And because they are, you will see scenes like that in film and television. So it all works together. You don't have to pretend that that you feel something you don't, or write about something you don't know about.
Yeah.
Watch TV, just watch TV and start watching for the kinds of scenes that recur, you know, breakup scenes.
Yeah.
And I think that Miami Vice actually pioneered so much of what we use in television tonight. It was a real departure. I don't think people realize how much of a departure it was from everything that had come before in terms of design, in terms of music, and the way that they used it.
The clothing of the
exactly
camera, everything,
yeah, the so, colors that they featured, it was really a departure. And going back and looking at it, of course, now we're used to it, but it was really the MTV generation that was in really watching that show, and all of that, of course, has affected what we do now. If you want to hear some, you know, Grey's Anatomy uses songs in amazing ways, and especially the closing song or the opening song of a show. Yeah. Station 19 used one of my client's songs in the opening montage of a scene in which there are firefighters responding and emergency, you know, ambulances responding to a fire. And there's a darkness in it because you know that the that what's going to happen here is not good. And they, you know, use my client's song called Drowning in the Darkness. Now,
your voice still echoes in my head. Your gentle touch, the words you said. Then you vanished like a ghost. You were gone when I awoke. But there's nothing I can do, 'cause I'm drowning in the darkness without you. Oh. Without you.
The darkness. Now, drowning in the darkness can be applied to a lot of different situations. Mm-hmm. It's that sense of despair and loss. And you see those scenes in film and television, and they use songs like that in film and TV. He's writing a song that honestly expresses those feelings first, then hoping that there will be a music supervisor who responds to it and likes it and uses it. And in this case, they did. They used it, almost 2 minutes of it up full. There was no dialogue or anything. You can really hear it in that show. So those are the kinds of placements that you really want to get, because people hear that song, millions of people, far more than radio. And then they hear it and they love it, and they come to find, they go looking for, they find it on Shazam, they'll Shazam it, or they'll find the lyric and they'll track it down because they heard something that they love that they wouldn't have heard otherwise, because it's not, the radio doesn't play a lot of songs.
And then you got the John Woods who are going, who is that? They go back and look through it, and we circle around. Nick Drake, why haven't I heard of this guy before? What have I been doing? You know, like, what has been going on? Then you find this, and it's like some sort of a treasure or a jewel or something.
Yeah.
And you go, I can't believe I missed it. I wrote down a note. I don't do notes for when I do my interviews. It's obviously it's a total wing. But I wrote down out of time. And it's an interesting word, because he was being so in time musically, so clever of his guitar playing. That 4-5 number, or 5-4 number, he did it.
Riverman is in 5-4. Yeah,
but it's
but
like
you never know it.
I
didn't realize it for years, and I
heard it. There's no sign going 5-4 right here.
Gonna see the Riverman. Gonna tell him all I can about the plan. If he tells me all he knows about the way his river flows and all night shows in summertime.
He was so fascinated with time, and also in his lyrics, he's fascinated with time. He doesn't feel he's moving in time, and yet his guitar playing is absolutely perfectly in time. Yeah. And he was out of his own time. No one.
That's right.
I mean, when you said you didn't know who he was, nobody knew who he was. Yeah. It wasn't until a Volkswagen commercial used one of his songs in a TV commercial, and people crashed the website looking for who that song was by.
That's right. Yeah.
And then they find him. It was 1999 when Volkswagen did that, and they find him, and they hear these beautiful jewels of just gem-like songs, and then they find out that he died in 1974, and there never will be any more.
Yeah.
And
I saw it written and I saw it say, Bingo Moon is on his way. None of you stand so tall. Bingo Moon, and I get you on some.
A fan once said that. She said, "You're so lucky to have known him, because we meet him now only to find out that he's gone." And yeah. it's such a letdown to find this beautiful music and then find out there won't be any more. And yeah. I had never thought of it from a fan's perspective, but that's the truth. And he was unknown in his lifetime, except to a few friends like me and a few other people. He didn't yeah. reach very many people. And now his name is fortunately widely known because of film and television. And that's a lot of what drew me in back into film and TV, was listening and watching the ways that they were using his songs. Mm-hmm. And I was saying, why do his songs work? Why don't they use, hit songs? Why are they using this unknown? And they were a lot between 1999 and 2007 mm-hmm. or 8, and they still use his songs. Why is that? Back in the day, reviewers said things like, well, there's no catchy hooks. I mean, there's really no chorus. I can't sing along. And now it's the perfect song for film and television because it evokes a mood and never changes that mood. Yeah. It never steps out in front of you and says, hey, listen to me. That wasn't his personality. He wasn't like that. And so his songs are like him. He wrote very personally, very exposed his own emotions, which was another thing we didn't do back in 1969.
That's right.
When that his first album came out. It wasn't until Joni Mitchell did the Blue album and people said, don't release that, it's too personal. And Joni Mitchell released it anyway. And people did know who she was talking about and it was personal, but that was a little later. Nick Drake was doing it when we did not do that.
Just got this image of Nick Drake with the Sandy Gray. You know, it's almost like he was a traveler through time. To get too esoteric here, but he was a traveler through time. So you could imagine him being in the medieval courts or as a musician, just traveling down a road and playing a song and having conversations and but yet into himself. It's just an interesting image of him. And he's probably still doing it, for that matter.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You know. So.
Well, his music is still doing it.
Yeah.
And I when I wrote about him, my articles about him.
Yeah, I read that.
For Mojo, and it's on my website. If you want to read it, you can just type in Nick Drake and Robin Frederick, and you'll come up with. If you're a Nick Drake fan, you'll find the articles.
Well, I am now. Thank you.
Right. Which is good. This is great. One of the things that I said was when I heard him singing his recording of home recording of my song from years before, Been Smoking Too Long, I didn't even remember that song. I'd forgotten it and I had to go back and find my handwritten lyrics and stuff to be sure it was mine. But as I'm listening to this and realizing, the realization dawned on me as I was listening to him, hear his voice sing my song back to me after 25, 30 years.
Wow.
It was like time just became a bridge.
Yeah.
And it was a thing, a physical bridge. And it wasn't like time only goes one direction. It can go in two directions when you relive your past that way. Mm-hmm. And I remember saying, I wrote a lot of songs then about that experience, about trying to deal with that and going back and trying to figure out how I had felt, why I felt that way. I kept saying, thank God I'm a songwriter. Because as a songwriter, you can go back and have a conversation with somebody that you couldn't have that conversation then for whatever reason, or they're gone now and you can't have it. You can write out those songs. And this is another aspect of writing from your personal experience, which I think is so important, is that you can pull those things out of your past and relive them emotionally and put those emotions into a song, release it to other people now, just put it on the internet. You don't even have to wait. And let that song find other people who've experienced that as well, because we're human. We're not Martians. None of us are Martians. We all share the same.
Well, there's a couple.
There are a couple, yeah. But most of us have had the same emotional experience, no matter who you are or where you live. And you're not unique. And that's one of the great things about being a songwriter, is discovering that you are not unique, that your own feelings are shared by other people. They discover that somebody else has shared that feeling by listening to your song, and they feel that they're not alone. And so this is the great healing power that songwriters have. Songs are extraordinarily powerful, far more than I think people ever stop to think about. We can make people feel things.
Music, you know, music in and of itself, when you see people playing music for animals out of the field, and the animals come, they congregate into the situation. It's really music is powerful. It's a powerful healing force, as you well know. Where do you see, or maybe if you could, you'd be the great seer of all time. Where do you see, as we look back using your time transference, as we look back to the 60s during our period of music, maybe late 50s through 60s through 70s, 80s, 90s, where music is going, we're not returning to disco, are we?
Oh, disco never died.
That's right.
I do want you to know that disco never left us. Right.
Tell me.
So just a brief one on that is because that's a really good question and I want to answer it. But disco never died. I mean, Rick Astley came along. That was disco. And when we listened to dance EDM, now electronic dance music, when you listen to Dua Lipa, Don't Start Now, it's disco. And she's even doing it. The producers are even doing it. There's the strings going up.
Don't show up. Don't come out. Don't start caring about me now. Walk away. You know how. Don't start caring about me now. Aren't you the guy who tried to hurt me with the word goodbye?
It's never gone. Our dance beats are still disco. And I have to say that because of that, disco actually revolutionized dance music. It was new, but it was the last new thing that we had in dance. So when we say, you know, dubstep or future bass or any of these things, we talk about them as if they're different, but they are basically disco. And I think that's wonderful. And because we've put more energy into the melody and the lyrics to disco now. So we're not singing Casey and the Sunshine Band simple.
Right.
Now these songs are really wonderful. Pink and Dua Lipa, who I adore, and Bebe Rexha. And I mean, there's some very, very good lyrics and lyric writers, particularly Dua Lipa. There are a lot of good dance songs. There's this stuff that's just made for the dance clubs. But when they bring it over into crossover into radio, as Dua Lipa does, then those lyrics have to be good. Pink does that when I go back and listen to some of her things. It's just great lyrics. And that we can learn how to put good lyrics into some of these simpler forms. We don't, as to where is music going? I think that really what we've been doing for decades now is refining, cross blending, putting them all in the blender and stirring it up and putting it back out again. Rap has had a huge influence rhythmically on what we do in today's pop, which is much more rhythm based than it was for the last few decades. Now pop is rhythm. It's really rhythm based, and the melodies are rhythm based. When you listen to Louis Capaldi sing Someone You Loved, which is a piano vocal hit record, just piano vocal, Someone You Loved. You listen to him, the way he's singing, it's rhythmical. His voice is providing the rhythm track now. Da 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 ba da 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 ba da 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 da.
I'm going under in this time. I fear there's no one to save me. This all or nothing really got away, you're driving me crazy. I need somebody to hear, somebody to know, somebody to have, somebody to hold. It's easy to say, but it's never the same. I guess I kinda like the way tonight for? And you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you loved.
Da, 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 da. Lots of repetition, rhythmical repetition. And so I've been writing about this lately because it's where melody is going. I don't think it's going to go backwards from here. Listeners yeah. love it. And so rhythm, melody will continue to be more rhythmical. Lyrics over the decades since the 70s and 80s, lyrics have become much more personal, personally revealing. Not necessarily personal, you don't know what happened to me, but I'm going to talk about it. They have become more personally revealing of our emotions. So what started with Nick Drake and Joni Mitchell revealing one's own feelings in one's songs has gotten more and more important in writing. And that's where that word authentic comes in, authenticity comes in, is you have to be honest about those emotions, and that can be very difficult. And when you listen to somebody like Nick Drake singing Parasite, I mean, I don't even know how anybody sings a song like that about themselves. It's just devastatingly revealing and dark.
Take a look, you may see me on the ground. For I am the parasite of this town. A dancing, a jig in the church with chimes, a sign of the times today. A hearing no from a steeple tall, people are dismay.
We do it. We do it now. You can hear it in contemporary singer-songwriters. And they also write about the things that make them feel joyful in very detailed, vivid ways that make you feel it too.
Right.
We weren't so, you know, I go back and I listen to Seals and Crofts. They weren't really singing about too much, you know. Summer yeah. Breeze makes me feel good. It's a lovely song. I love that song. I loved it when it was a hit, and I love it now, Summer Breeze by Seals and Crofts. Right. But it's not enough for today's listeners to just say the Summer Breeze makes me feel good. You have to all then continue on with how that Summer Breeze makes you feel that, and what it makes you want to do, and how it makes you think about tomorrow and yesterday. And I mean, there's all this stuff.
Well,
that
apparently
goes
it makes you feel good.
Yes, it does. Now, what does that mean, good?
Yeah, exactly right.
That's what you have to write about now. You have to say, what does that mean? It makes me feel good. Oh, it makes me feel like, you know, bubbling soda, you know, in the afternoon, and it makes me feel like popsicles, and it makes me feel like warm summer days at the beach and running into the water and feeling the splash of the waves. And it makes me feel all of these things you can compare. Good makes me feel good. You compare it to lots of things. I just made a bunch of stupid stuff. But if I were going to make a song, write a song about a summer breeze that makes me feel good now, I would need to compare good to lots of things that the listener can feel and has either experienced or can feel for themselves or taste for themselves or hear or,
you know, using all the senses, right?
You got to get those senses in there because that engages listeners now, and listeners want to be engaged. If you don't engage them, they'll push that button or change, you know, click on another song. They're gone. It's so easy now to be gone. And just go to the next song and the next song.
In so many ways, our attention span these days is so short, you know.
We're distracted by so much, even more than we had. But I mean, it's always been distractions, kids, dogs, driving in the car. There've always been distractions. But listeners now demand of lyrics something they didn't used to. So I think we're going to continue to go in that direction. I don't see things changing much from what they are. Things are evolving. We are blending styles. I hear a lot of 80s being blended into today's songs. I'm hearing a lot of cover songs, and those covers are 60s, 70s, 80s, and even 90s being reinterpreted by today's singer-songwriters and bands in ways that people never thought of before. Yeah. And so a lot of repurposing and rediscovery is going on. I see creativity being musically at the same level as the creativity I saw in the 60s. I don't think we have ever been in a more creative time than we are now, with music that's any better as far as pop music, we have never been in a better time. It's the equivalent, it's as good as the 60s. And people who say, oh, no, there'll never be another band like the Beatles. There are bands that are phenomenal and artists that are phenomenal. And comparing them is pointless because no one will ever do what the Beatles did. They put together the American Standard Songbook with rock and roll.
Right.
Nobody ever will do that again because it's been done. And so we simply accept it as part of our music.
I remember that part in your writing about that moment, you know, on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Oh yeah.
There's a moment right there that rings across an entire generation,
as
whether it's me being from born in England, of the pride of that aspect of it, to make me want to play guitar, to want to be in a band like millions of other people, not just here in America, but all around the world.
You know, listen
to the songs like that, and the songs were really good. You know, when you break a Beatles song down, you're going, where did they come up with that? But
well, they came up with that from American Standards.
That's
Paul McCartney, who has said that he loves American Standards, the American songbook from the 30s and 40s and 50s. On the end of the last song on their very first album in the US, Meet the Beatles, was Till There Was You from The Music Man. And it's Paul singing it. And he sings, Till There Was You. And it's so sweet. And so he had studied American songbook structure, the melodies, the chords. You hear them when they're doing that verse, bridge, verse.
Yep.
And then the bridge, he goes to one of those chords that you would have heard Lerner and Lowe or Rodgers and Hammerstein or Rodgers and Hart. You would hear one of those chords that they would go to.
Yeah.
But Lennon was bringing, and they both loved early rock. They both loved Chuck Berry, and they both loved all of the American blues and rock. And so they were blending the energy of rock with the structure and the dynamics of American songbook. And that's why those songs are so good. People think that the Beatles came up with this out of thin air. They didn't. No. They're doing exactly that. It's just that no one had done that before, and they certainly weren't doing it as well as the Beatles.
It's those 10,000 hours.
They're in
Hamburg having to play, you know, however long was it, 5-6 hours at night or however it was, and they're playing everything they know, and they got really good. So they when everything came together, they hit the ground running. So
yes,
it was fabulous.
I was just watching a documentary on Little Richard. It's a new documentary. It was just on CNN, and it might be on again. I'll
look for it. Yeah.
Yeah. Check it out. Yeah, I'm sure you can find it somewhere. And he played Hamburg for 30 days in a row. And the Beatles were the opening act. Paul McCartney says, sitting and listening to Little Richard and watching him for 30 days, 30 nights in a row, I went to school. I learned it. And that's it. You can see it in their performance after that. And you can see it in the energy of the early rock that they blended with what the other styles that he and John Lennon liked.
Isn't that funny though, that their sets back in those days were 30 minutes, right? They come out, they bang out, they do 30 minutes at Shea Stadium. See ya, we're out of here. Now you've got Bruce Springsteen and Taylor doing, 3-hour sets or 2.5-hour or 3-hour sets. Every song I ever wrote. You know?
Every song I ever wrote. I don't know that I could take that. I've seen Bruce Springsteen and I loved it. But
me
that
too.
Level of energy for 2.5 hours or something, I don't know that I could take it.
Guy has great pitch. The guy has absolutely. I saw him come out at the Sports Arena years ago.
I saw that one too.
Did you? Yeah. And he acapella'd something. It was something around Christmas time for some reason. And he acapella'd a song. I'm going, that guy's got great pitch.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, you know what? We're going to draw to a close because I want to have you back again sometime if you're up for it.
Sure.
Because I know there's a million stories, and we've touched on some fabulous stuff. Thanks for all of your wealth of information and knowledge. And great to touch bases with you again. You're fabulous. You're wonderful. And I'll include some photos and also contact information, because I know people, all my big fan base of four people, will want to find out what more is Robin Frederick doing and go down the rabbit hole? And I couldn't imagine going down the rabbit hole with a nicer person. Thank you.
It's been a lot of fun. Thank you.
Johnny on the Spot. Bye.
And that was Johnny on the Spot. Don't forget to like and subscribe.